Welcome back, everyone, to the Insomnia True Silver Championship. We're just done with the first semifinals match. We had Super JJ versus Legendaren, who ended up winning 3-2. It was a pretty close, the almost the interesting last Lloyd. Series, last game that
Lloyd
is.
Was just
insane. Yeah. Probably the one of the most tense matches I've ever casted.
Well, with RDU and Life Coach, it's hard to top. But I'd say it's probably one of the most interesting ones. So the next one we've got, the second semifinals, we've got RDU is going to be playing against Visual. Visual, again, one of the players who didn't really know what he'd be getting into, I think, once he joined the tournament. He was hoping, basically, to attend for the experience, and he's done a lot better than he thought he would.
Yeah, it's been a pretty good experience for him, I'd say, overall, so far.
And he's already top four, right?
So yeah, not bad for your first go at it, right?
Yeah, it's 2.5K. Already in the pocket.
Yeah, and we can see the bracket now, but I think for Visual, like, he needs to continue with what he seemed as the positive mindset of just, like, really happy to be here, just want to see what I can do, but just enjoying it already. And I think that actually helps relax you, as opposed to thinking, probably, oh, my God, I'm up against RDU next, you know, hell of an opponent, and thinking that, like,
I can make it.
Yeah. Just say, you know what, I'm just going to enjoy the match. He's been playing well enough to get through so far, so he's doing something, right?
Yeah. He just needs to get those double mana worms.
Just keep getting those and you'll be just fine. I mean, I think RDU would get a little bit salty about that. That being said, we do need to watch the video about those players, see what they have to say about the event. You'll see just how happy Visual is to be here and how much RDU wants to win the tournament.
Hi, my name's Daniel. I go by the nickname Visual. Originally from Australia, but I'm currently living in London, and actually I entered this competition through the UK qualifier, which I ended up winning, and here I am into the main tournament. I'm just absolutely ecstatic, just over the moon. I mean, I never expected to get this far, and you know, win or lose, it's just a great experience, and yeah, I'm just loving life. The biggest challenge is professional players do probably understand the game a bit better than I do, and just trying to bring myself to that level, and I'm trying to do it as quick as possible. You know, I want to say, you know, I'm going to go and win it, but truth be told, I'm hoping I can just get through at least the first best of five and just take it from there.
My name is Dima Radu. I'm also known as RDU, and I play for Team G2 Esports. I am from Romania, and I came here to win the tournament. This has been the most intense day of my life. I literally started by losing the first two series. I wanted to basically go home because I thought there is no way out. But I heard that I still might have some chances. I tried my best. I won the last series. Some results happened exactly as I wanted them to happen. And then in the tiebreakers, while my opponents were shaking and tilting, I managed to pull myself together, play some good strong Hearthstone, and manage to get myself through. I am feeling really good about tomorrow because it's a fresh new start for everybody. It doesn't matter if you win the group or if you get second in the group or if you win the tiebreakers, you can just not predict the results. Anything can happen.
You hear that confidence in RDU's voice. Like, everybody around me was tilting. It was like the apocalypse, but I stayed calm and I pulled
legend.
Through.
And played some strong Hearthstone.
Yeah, some very strong Hearthstone.
Yeah, so, well,
it was good.
It's very, very, like, enjoyable to hear those opinions of the
course.
Players, right?
That's what I love about RDU. It's just any time where he talks about the tournament he's attending, it's always, you know, how good he thinks his lineup is, how powerful he thinks it is. And when he loses, no salt, he's just like, yeah, it happens. You know, I will win eventually. It's the long term that matters. But he seemed very stressed out.
And then he's like, well, I made mistakes here and there and here and there. So.
List every misplay.
Yeah, exactly. So he's one of the players that is really taking hard on mistakes from himself, but at the same time he acknowledges them and wants to improve. That's a feat for a very good player in future, an example.
Yeah, like you have to have that, I think, that feature in order to, I mean, that trait rather, to improve, because some people who are blindsided by their own, you know, they think they're just, there's nothing to improve. They think they're playing just fine.
It's all the RNG that happens.
Always,
right?
You know, it's the shredders
Faster,
that don't work
right?
out. It's the arcane missiles. Yes, there's some of that, but overall, you do have to learn a lot of stuff. Even the mulligan phase takes forever to master. So.
Yeah.
Yep.
All right, so we see Visual with the Tempo Mage that we know he's holding. He's also playing a Reno Warlock, if I'm not mistaken, as well as a Face Hunter, which is actually really solid against RDU's Warlock and his aggro pally.
Yeah, the lineup actually favors Visual, I think.
Yeah.
I think, and RDU wants to take advantage of his experience and knowledge of the game against Vizor, because Vizor is a, let's say, intermediate player, right? He's new to the game.
He doesn't do that many tournaments.
Yeah. he just actually has. I mean, there's not a lot of people with more experience than RDU, actually. He's been playing at a high level for quite a long time, and obviously Visual's on the other end of that scale. He went to play in the tournament just because he thought, why not? So you're completely correct. The experience is probably going to show through here, especially because even in Visual's last set, although he won, he definitely showed some sort of shaky plays.
Yeah, and some of those that didn't seem optimized.
And RDU will just punish that. And I think RDU going into this, knowing Visual's not, even though he's an unheard of player, he still has a lot to learn in terms of playing optimally.
So Visual as well, I think, took out Tice in the group stage really, really convincingly. If I remember correctly, Tice brought up the fact that Tempo Mage really took him off guard, and Visual with a good start ended up taking that deck and carrying it forward. So this could be a bit of a revenge from RDU for Tice. But
yeah, and we've said that across the weekend, where with so many decks that are actually viable, it's hard to plan for everything. And even Visual's lineup overall, Reno locked Hunter, I think he's the only Hunter that we've seen.
Yeah.
And then Tempo Mage, again, not common in this tournament specifically. So all these plays used to playing against a certain set of decks, and you throw three, you're not really too common. Maybe the Reno lock's the most common about out of the three. So they're definitely going to throw players off.
Yeah. So here we might see the one of the only cases where playing Peddler on the coin is not correct, is when you want to coin out the Imgang boss. That's about the only time where you do not go for a coin Peddler on turn one.
Yeah, agree. Or if you do really want to have that Twilight Drake on turn three, but in this situation,
right? Because you get one card, but you sacrifice one health on the Drake for that play.
Yeah, the Imgang boss on turn two is especially devastating in most of the situations here against the Paladin. Unless there will be Blessing of Might, an example.
Yeah, that would be a really good outcome, though, for RDU. Picking up Blessing of Might would change the way this game pans out, because right now on 3, not only does he have nothing, but the Imgang boss can spawn imps from the 1-ups.
We'll see what will be drawn for RDU. Like, the Blessing of Might will be really cool. The same goes actually for Divine Favor, that will draw 2 cards, which is not that. Well, okay.
Would you play Arcane Intellect? If the answer is yes, then it's all right.
Yeah, it's all right, right?
Pretty much.
Exactly.
But instead, he draws the Keeper of Alderman and only Hero Power this turn. And then, do you even want to Hero Power? Because you're potentially going to generate an additional minion from the Imgang boss.
But maybe that's fine. You can kill it. Like, the thing you're looking for is to have something on the board for that Kings.
Yeah.
Right? But now, with the bad juggle, means the 1-1 is negated.
It's either you lose the Divine Shield or you lose 2 damage to the face. That's the question.
Yeah, it's a pretty tough one. I almost feel like you could let it live. Because the juggler will kill the Imgang boss and the 1-1 kills the 1-1. If you want to play for value like he's doing, then you're killing the 1-1 to guarantee that your Kings has a target.
Ooh. Reno Jackson already in hand. Yeah, this is something that might stop RDU in his tracks.
Yeah.
Just single-handedly.
It also means Visual can be a bit more playful and not maybe rely on the, say, the Othering Farseer this turn for the heal, just to be super defensive. Because if Reno...
You could heal the Imgang boss.
That's true. If Reno wasn't a card, then playing against a hyper-aggressive deck, you'd probably just drop Farseer at this point for the body and the 2 heal. But with Reno in hand, like, you don't have to focus as much healing on yourself. And like you said, he's going to just heal onto the gang boss, trade into the juggler, create a 1-1, leave the 2-1 on the board, and he still has a lot of options going forward as well.
Yeah, I mean, look at that 5-5, though, on the Ardent Squire side. That is an annoying minion if Vassil doesn't have the answer.
So you would like to just play the +4/+4, kill the 1-1 with the 1-1, and just go face for 5.
Yeah, it's that or you go for the Shredder play, which is also not a bad one, but again, that board can be cleaned up a little bit with a Hellfire.
Yeah.
The thing is as well, even the 5-5, he can deal with it over multiple turns, and the face damage, well, we just know it's sort of going to get negated, because
that's actually a lot safer, right? That's a lot safer.
That's actually a very clever move.
Yeah, like that a lot from RDU. Killing the 3-3, guaranteeing that if there's a Hellfire, it's going to pass the Warlock's turn, and he's going to lose his board, and I get to play a Shredder on an empty board.
Yeah.
This is also where you can see how powerful Keeper of Ulduman is. It's just so has so many targets that you can just use on it on.
With Creepers, with Ardent Squires.
Yeah, especially with the Ardent Squires. It's basically like a
Thinkmaster over Spark in the middle of the ground, I guess. Middle road, Thinkmaster.
Oh, it's like a Houndmaster, right?
Yeah.
For Paladin to a large extent, on if on on the on his side of the board.
Well, it doesn't give the taunt, right?
Well, no, but it's probably it's a better body though, right?
Yeah, that's true.
So do you kings the 3-4 or the 3-3 here? Because if you kings the 3-4, you can kill the Drake. But then again, if there is anything like a big game hunter, it goes down anyway.
Do you want to kings anything?
Do you, sorry?
Do you just want to play Treader?
It's possible, but again, if you're expecting AoE, maybe overextending any further is not a
yeah,
play.
Yeah, that's
right?
true.
That's the. It's really a matter of how much do you expect to be taken by AoE? Do you maybe just play the Owl and trade the 3-3? Because I'll trade the 3-3, gives you a 2-1, but it's not something amazing. And you might need it later.
Yeah, there's no like great option here. It's just gonna play the 1-1s instead.
Interesting turn.
So it should be the Shredder then, right?
Yeah.
Leroy!
Yeah, because I think like playing around AoE by Hero Power Pass definitely isn't the right move as the aggressive deck. I guess you just play the Shredder, hope that it doesn't have Shadow Flame.
I mean, if he has it, at least you've taken that out of the way, right? Like, yeah. At some point you have to reset. The problem is with no board, Divine Favor is going to have to be the card that fetches you that refill.
Yeah. And Hellfire and actually is looking pretty good, because the minion from the Shredder probably isn't going to have 3 attack.
Would you play the Hellfire instead of the Belcher?
So
no, you can clear the board and
value,
leave,
right?
You can clear the board and leave the Drake on, probably, with Hellfire.
I mean, you could play the Belcher and milk more value out of the Hellfire, because you weaken everything a little bit. And you
I would definitely go for the Belcher.
Yeah, sounds about right, because you're not under any danger yet.
You
and
have
so you can
Reno
take
Jackson.
Your time. And the Reno will save you if everything becomes way too difficult to handle.
Definitely the correct way to play the Belcher here.
I like that, but Visual is considering the alternatives, and not wrongly so, could you go for Brand, Peddler?
Actually, the Peddler and Sunfury is not that bad either.
Against a board like that one, yeah, it does solve. Because it does kill most minions on it. So you really don't need the Belcher for defensive purposes right now. So maybe keeping it for a point where you're going to need the health protection is good. But with Reno, I think Vigil is feeling overly safe. So, Owl on the Belcher.
I'm thinking about the Owl and then
Keeper.
Blessing of Kings.
I was thinking Keeper
aggressive.
On the Drake, but yeah, I like Blessing of Kings as well.
Keeper on the Drake doesn't do anything.
Yeah, you're not really looking
three
to
HP.
Yeah, you're not looking to trade. It's already on 3.
So it's just like a decrease one.
Yeah, it does nothing. Like it's just to reduce the
I think Owl Blessing of Kings is fine.
Yep, there's a Blessing of Kings being played on the Palto Shredder.
Wow, that's a lot of damage. And now, with the trades
Gardy
is getting, the Hellfire is no longer viable.
That's a very good move.
Yeah, he's making sure that he's just out of range of any clear that Vigil might be able to pull together.
It's very interesting. Like, I would have gone face.
Yeah.
I'm the player that just, like, you know,
you're playing the aggressive deck, you want to go face. But I think RDU is fine with not doing so because he sees that he's got the
divine
favor.
I like a little.
And he knows he's against Reno Lock as well. So if you overcommit and just go face and then Reno does come down, they can probably clear your board, play Reno, and then, like, well, I've got no. You need to put yourself in a position to burst and then have follow up for if Reno happens, you burst back again
Whoa.
To reset the board.
I was
we
really
didn't
surprised.
See the PO with Shadow Flame.
Yeah, exactly. I was really surprised that he didn't go for the PO. The PO with the Sunfear Protector is just amazing clear.
But the Oven Archer kills a lot of stuff in a deck like that one, or at least what comes out of the hero power. So that might be relevant. You can kill the Owl now or coil it. He does go for the Archer to kill the Owl. Interesting. So.
Ooh.
That is a rough draw for Vigil. He's not going to like that one.
Definitely not.
Yeah, followed by
Divine Favor.
Yeah.
Free card draw for 3 mana. Seems like a very good deal.
Pick up a Squire and weave it in at the end, because why not?
Maybe Bless even Blessing might. Of Might.
Yeah, I was going to say, like, Blessing. The thing is, you have to push with Blessing to force the Reno, if there's one, so that you can then play other things. Well. We'll see what RDU does, but I'd be surprised if we didn't see a Divine Favor this turn.
So he wants to trade first.
Yeah, get the shield on afterwards.
It's an interesting turn.
Well, I think it kind of makes sense, right? Because if you trade after, that. It's on 4 health and it dies to a tiny bit more stuff. And then that Leeroy is going to be so bursty.
I wasn't sure about the trade there. You know, he just lost 8 damage.
I think, like I said, though, he's waiting until he can hit for 8, if it still survives, and then be able to follow up. And now that he has the Keeper of All the Men, the Minibot, and the Blessed of Might, he might be able to provide a follow-up a little bit more. So just playing Reno won't be enough, because at this point in the game, the Reno's like the whole turn, pretty much.
Yeah, it's like, so heal yourself for 15. Like, yeah, Alex then draws, burst against 15. 15 damage.
Yeah, and then I've just reset the board, except now I've got more minions.
Yeah. Well, we'll see what Visual does. I mean, the second coil gives him a tiny bit more wiggle room as far as what he can do, but it still feels awkward. Because if what comes out of the Shredder is not favorable to your coils, then suddenly he's left with stuff on the board. Maybe you double coil Hellfire and hope that nothing comes out of it that has 4 health.
Yeah, that's actually a better move, because the only minions that have 4 HP is either Manhouse, which is awful, of course, for him, or just minion that has 1 attack, so it's not a big of a deal.
Yeah, like Nerubar, you got a Dragon Guy, that's about it. Low Rocket Show, that's right, Natpagel, but those...
Natpagel will be annoying.
Yeah, very annoying.
But that's it.
In that deck like that. When he doesn't kill the minions, he's getting greedy, and he can be, because he's got the Reno Jax.
Yeah. 6 damage from RDU, and might be Hero Power Blessing of Might.
Well, one of the problems with not using, say, overextending or playing Blessing of Might now, where there's no blessing, no shields, is that one AoE deals with your entire buffs. But does he think that Visual doesn't have AoE because he hasn't played it?
That's the question. That's the biggest question.
In this position, what would you do?
I would have gone for the Blessing of Might and Hero Power. You saw 2 blessing Mortal Cores, so it's pretty damn sure that your 5-1 can die to a just single damage source apart from... Wait, the 1 Mortal Core was from Dark Peddler.
Yeah, yep. 1 from Silver the Peddler, and there's another one lying in the deck, so...
Okay,
he used 2 coils.
Yeah,
he's Reno Lock.
Oh, yeah, oh, right. What are we talking about?
Never mind that.
Is he playing 2 coils?
No one told me this. That's right. You wouldn't surrender the value of Reno for 1 coil. Not worth.
Sometimes it's good, but I don't think it's ever that good. I think this is okay.
Sylvanas Sun Fury could be played, but it kind of makes nothing but a weakening of the board. But if you're not going to play Reno, you're not going to Hellfire, that's as slow as you're going to be allowed to get.
Well, Hellfire here has value.
I like it, yeah.
Because that 5 is a lot of damage, never mind the rest of the minions. And I think the thing is as well for IDU, if you continually try and play around everything that Arena Lock can have, you're not really going to do anything, right? If you can't just play around AoE for the whole game, because you will never win.
Visual right now is being super greedy about that Reno. One of the things that he may not have considered. Say what?
He's already seen an owl.
Yeah, he's seen 1 owl, but one of the things he maybe hasn't considered is that you can't play Hellfire and Reno next turn. So if things go wrong now, you can only play Reno alone, and it's a little bit further down the line that you're able to clear the board.
Yeah. I think the idea is, though, that in killing Sylvanas, which you presume there's not going to be a second owl, then Sylvanas steals a minion. The 2-3 is probably going to trade okay versus what's on the board. So maybe he thinks he can get away with just Reno. Reset to 13, the board isn't already massive.
Well, you're almost certain to deal 5 damage to the face.
Yeah, pretty much. No matter what, you get 5 that goes through. Keeper of Uldumon could be used even to buffer that up a tiny bit.
I was thinking
or
about
reduce
using
the Sylvanas.
I was thinking about using Keeper of Uldumon on the Sylvanas.
And Trucial Red Down.
Yeah, but then you don't...
You waste the damage, right?
You waste the damage and you don't have the 1-1, the additional 1-1.
Wow, good outcome there.
Very good outcome for RDU. He deals a lot of damage. I really like the switch of the weapon. Because this is the turn when you... Actually, what you said about the Hellfire is very important right now to have that additional burst.
Yeah, and right now that's what Visual might not have thought about last turn, which is If I play Sylvanas with Sunfury, my turn 9 cannot be Reno Hellfire. It's one or the other. So now he might be forced into going for Shredder plus the Defender and then go for the Hellfire, wipe the board, then play the Reno.
Yeah.
Go back to full health, go with Jiraxxus, and from there reevaluate. But one of the things that Jiraxxus does is set his max health to 15. And when it sets his max health to 15, RDU is able to burst him down. I mean, Leroy deals 6. Blessing of Might times 1 is an extra.
And the Truce of a Champion deals with the boosted Pile Shredder.
Right, exactly.
So it's not a good minion at all.
Nothing here feels very good. And if he goes for Reno now, he is mitigating damage, but he's going to have to pilot this very cautiously. And I don't even know how easy that would be.
Use BGH Shadowflame then? If you wanted to just clear off. It's not the best clear, I guess.
Here right now? Oh.
No, the last turn.
Yeah, pre-tap, like after tap.
He life tapped down to he life tapped down to 13, and he had 7 mana. Could have gone for BGH and Shadow Flame, but it's a bit.
That's very risky. He would actually be dead.
Yeah, he taking 4, 5, 6, 8. 7,
that's 14
8.
Damage.
Yeah, he'd be dead.
Yeah, he would be dead to Leroy actually.
So he did make the play that kept him alive, but that means I mean now that he has 30 health and RDU has to start thinking about trading, right?
Does he?
I mean, I think RDU might trade the 2-1 and the 1-1 away, if anything, if he ever decides to make Reno a 3-3.
I don't know if he can.
Silver in the 2-1? Shadow Flame, man. That thing hurts. That thing hurts
but
a
the
lot.
Problem is, he's out of cards.
Yeah.
So if he kills Reno, that's more of his resource gone. And again, if you play around the Shadow Flame, is he going to?
Oh, he doesn't have the choice, I think, because Hellfire is an issue. But at least Hellfire leaves your spider alive and the 2-2. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's a good point.
Yeah.
Ooh, the dog. Never
mind. I lied again, but that 3-4 does not die.
So you have to play Big Game Hunter into Shadow Flame.
I think you're right, but you can even play Dark Bomb as well, so that's going to work out sort of okay, right?
If the second Divine Favor will be drawn for RDU, this will change the entire game.
Yeah, it will draw an entire hand, and at that point, Leroy can probably kill in the next few turns, and he can get another True Silver, more weapons. That's a lot of damage taken.
I would be very surprised if he plays a Hellfire.
He's
prepared to be surprised.
It looks like he's willing to take the risk.
Wow.
That's a lot of damage coming in, though. Shredder, I mean, he does contest the board, but how well?
I mean, it's not really that great at contesting the board because you have a lot of damage that are divided
into
small minions.
Is he relying on his opponent to burst him and then just go straight into Draxus and hope that's enough?
I don't hate that. That might be the only...
Because then he's hurt himself and then he's like, well, he's not going to just put all of his minions into the Shredder at this point. He's seen Reno, so his opponent should now know that that's out of the deck so he can try and just finish up the game. That might be the case here. And then Draxus will actually just stall out even longer. And the second you can spawn 6/6s into the Argus, then you know that you should presume game over.
Okay, this Shadow Flame into Lotheb is such a safe play.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's no way that RDU can finish.
Right.
Spawn because he used to Blessing of Mights
already.
Already, so there's no burst with Leroy after.
Has he played two kings?
Divine Favor.
We saw one, but there probably are two.
I mean, there won't be enough anyway.
Right. It may be enough over a few turns, but in this case, it's not going to be.
Yeah.
We do know, however, that RDU is running Arcane Golem, I think, as a single of.
Yes.
So that's a total of 10 damage right there that he can get just through minions. So assuming things line up, I think RDU, if Visual decides to be even more greedy, could get it done. Is there anything that Visual gets out of the Shredder that's bad for him?
Well, I think what Visual is thinking here is that he can... Oh my god, he's tapping.
You going for the Shadow Flame instead?
Yep, looks like it.
But he tapped. Now he can be dead.
Why would you Shadow Flame the Shredder?
Well, if you Shadow Flame it, you go face first and you get a 2-drop out of it.
But the tap was not needed at
he
all.
He might die now. There is a chance that he dies to an Arcane Golem or a Kings.
Oh my god!
That's a card draw. What is he missing? 2 mana. He can't possibly find lethal here. He can't possibly find lethal.
Hardened Squire.
That's a very, very good card to find. Wow. Unbelievable.
Pretty okay combo.
Yeah. And this Garrison Commander doing nothing for Visual.
You've just seen the one Hellfire. You've seen the one Shadow Flame. You, c- can't expect an AoE after this.
Demon Wrath is the only one that exists.
But there's still so many cards in Visual's deck. The odds on him drawing three AoEs by now is so low.
Right, I wouldn't bet on it. And now if there's a Draxxus, 100% you're seeing it because of the fear. Unless Emperor plus Defender. Which
Emperor and Defenders actually, I think, better option.
Yeah, because you get to play...
You can kill the Knife Juggler with the Commander.
Does RDU win, though? Because Leeroy kills the 6-6. The weapon kills the 3-4.
Well, he's missing for damage.
He's just shy. I mean, he's got it in his deck, though. King.
Oh, my God. That's it, right?
That's game.
That's game for
RDU. RDU takes it. Game one is going to RDU with that Leeroy kill.
Leeroy into 6-6, 1-1 into 1 into 3-1.
You win.
I think yeah, the taps were very, very...
The last tap without the low step was very risky.
Oh, yeah. He's using just Arcane Golem into it, yeah.
Whoa, you worried us for a second there.
Lothars, you
sorry,
scared
I'm
everybody.
Just, I have such a headache.
Happy Feast of Wintervale.
Yep, Leroy Jenkins. I didn't see that card for a long time.
Yeah, you're about to see it come back, because RDU says this Paladin deck is actually pretty pretty solid. One of the things that's interesting is that the use of the Keeper of Uldumon, initially we thought, oh, it's going to be used very often as an Aldor Peacekeeper. No. It barely ever is, right?
And not in this deck. I mean, in this deck is a very...
Even in control decks, you rarely see it. You see, like, Muster 3, then you buff up a 1-1, kill a Shredder. Something along those
lines. Yeah, but when you think about it, in this particular deck, the Keeper of Uldumon is such a great card. It acts kind of like a Keeper of the Grove for Druid. Because it can either help you push through a taunt or just boost a minion so it will actually deal more damage, which is similar to your to damage from the Keeper, right?
Yeah. But hey, Visual playing a little bit too loose with his life there, I think.
Yeah, he saw the Reno and he's like, I can do what I want, right?
And he didn't ever draw into Healbot, right?
He never did, but I mean, he did draw a good chunk of his deck. Yeah. He had a Mal'Ganis left somewhere. Yeah. So you might have counted on that at some point. And we'll see the Aggro Hunter from Visual, which I think should have the edge in the matchup like this with the explosive traps, assuming no buffs come out that are too big on the
So actually, the Face Hunter is favored against every single deck from RDU, right?
Yeah, that's the case.
Yeah, we know Visual's running two explosive and one snake as well, and I'm sure RDU has that information. We saw a few run into jugglers with snake trap on the Visual's last game, which was a little bit rough. Changed the game quite dramatically, actually, with those
6-0 jugglers. 6-0 was taken off guard.
Minibot, just two damage to the face. RDU will just try to outraise the Hunter, right? Because he can't outvalue the Hunter. He can't overextend. Trading is just too slow.
Yeah, you
just thinking about the big
minions,
picture.
That's right. It's like, what's your game plan in general? Like, how do you play it like a druid? You know, two or three minions at a time, and then sit on it, deal as much as you can, start again.
I think with the cards he's got as well, like he can coin into either Keeper or the Shredder next turn, or even Blessing of Kings, because Blessing of Kings will demand an Owl, but then that's two mana that you've already done the attack with the Blessing of Kings, and then the Owl is two mana the Hunter's using that isn't really damage. It's damage mitigation, but it's not damage in the race.
Now we see Visual using the Spider to pop the 2-1, which is obviously an overkill, but he might have felt like he didn't have alternatives. And now we see RDU, you know, he plays one Shredder in his deck, which is just enough in this case to threaten the Leok and be annoying.
I would rather think of the Blessing of Kings. If you play Blessing of Kings, you can kill the Leok.
And then
still have a 6-6 on board. The problem is that there might be a silence from the Hunter. And he saw that Visual is playing two Owls in his deck.
Yeah.
So there's actually a very high probability of having that.
I suppose the benefit of the silence, or like the redeeming feature of the silence for RDU, is that, well, he still deals with the 2-1-1s on board as a 2-2.
Yeah, that's true.
So it kind of eats up the tempo that the Hunter might try to get through some of his own minions. And you're forcing him to slow down. And if that happens, and you then follow it up with a Shredder, he may not have another answer to that one.
Yeah, but the Knife Juggler will make a huge difference.
Yeah, absolutely. And a Quick Shot as well. It's a big deal. The hand's almost empty, and Quick Shot's going to cycle, plus kill possibly a Shredder. So We're talking about soon enough, Visual's going to be able to keep drawing when RDU's Divine Favors are dead.
Yeah, and also, again, like they might just hit the situation where he has Divine Favor in hand and versus Face Hunter.
Yeah.
Not the most reliable Divine Favor in the world.
It does nothing.
So even if he gets a quick shot only drawing one card, which, like you said, will be enough for the Hunter just to... Oh, he got the Juggler as well.
Very nice hit there for Visual. RDU knows this is going to spell trouble. He's going to hope. Oh, muster for battle on turn five with the Juggler for RDU.
That might be a comeback for him that he needed.
Yeah, it's the in the opposite fashion where Hunter needs Juggler Unleashed to actually come back against the Paladin. And on the other side of that, the Paladin can do the Juggle Muster, so that's going to be huge. And just being able to just drop the Shredder as well. So it's like, well, you can ignore the Shredder, but then it just makes his next turn even better. Or if you trade into it, then again, he's sort of ahead on the race.
Yeah, it's all about slowing down the opponent. I think Visual, if he picks up Unleash the Hound, though, is going to be in a great spot.
Well, he can also bluff the Snake Drop.
Why not?
Drop, right?
You empty your hand, set up a quick shot.
Yeah, I think that's actually correct. See what are his options. Ooh, and then Juggler another time.
Kind of liking that. And Explosive Sheep. No, it's not.
Oh, that would be so perfect.
Oh, is the second Juggler going to hit?
He's been pretty good so far, but this hasn't been...
This is worth a quick shot, right?
I don't think so.
Really? Do you not want to guard your Juggler?
How much? Well...
You're not expecting Consecrate.
I mean, how much does he play?
I would rather play the Explosive Trap.
I'd play the Trap here.
Yeah.
Bluff the Trap.
But he does play around... Like, he gets the other Explosive Trap out, and he also plays with the maximization of the Hero Power. So he gets to do it on turn 6 with Explosive, possibly, and the other two draws. But now look at that Juggler from RDU. Wow.
Well, at least he hit once. Right?
Don't look at that Juggler from RDU. Turn your eyes away in shame, for he betrayed his master in the perfect hand dump for Visual here.
Yep, Glaive Zuka into Trap, into Hero Power, deal 2 damage to the face. You don't even care about the Knife Juggler at this point.
Not with a Trap, not after you've seen One Kings. The only thing that saves those minions is the Keeper of Uldumon, and how much does that really bother you?
Yep.
When you're so far ahead on the race, you can initiate it, and you're going to win just based off your Hero Power.
Yeah, and the next turn, it's highly likely that you can play whatever he draws, and then onto Quick Shot as well. So we even carry on, and probably Hero Power as well if it's not another minion he wants to play.
Yep, agree.
Are we going to see RDU play Finley and try and get some sort of armor up?
He might be able to win the game because of that armor up or the heal from Priest. All it looks like very little.
It removes the Hero Powers from the game.
Completely. They nullify each other, and now it's just a matter of getting the most damage out. Hunters are supposed to win that race. But...
All right. Now, RDU knows that if he pops the Mad Scientist, he will get the Snake Trap out.
Yeah.
Unless it's already in hand.
How much does he care? That's the real question.
Well, he needs to pop the Explosive Trap at some point.
Yeah. But do you do it before or after you use Keeper of Uldumon and your Juggler to save it?
I suppose he could trade in to the... Yeah, it's whether he wants to pop Explosive, then kill the Scientist, then pop the second Explosive next turn with just the weapon.
Mm-hmm.
And we'll see whether or not he's able to get himself a Hero Power he likes.
Shapeshift is going to be the best. It was Shapeshift, the Rogue Hero Power, the Dagger, Shaman Totem.
Shaman Totem's not bad, but with the possibility of the
Unleash,
it's really problematic. Because when you do get Stoneclaw, it's just as bad, because you filled the board up with a bunch of rubbish.
Mm-hmm. Well, look at that. That Blessing of Might will actually make a huge difference. 6 damage to the face, Hunter's at 18.
GG.
Whoa.
Oh my god.
runner, quick shot, and that's game.
That's just 10 damage.
Yeah, it's over.
Wow.
They don't call it Face Hunter for no reason.
Wow, 2 quick shots on the deck. It's actually interesting when I think about it. Because not everyone runs 2 quick shots.
Even in the face decks? Because this is literally, it's not even a hybrid.
It's not hybrid, it's actually
pure face. So in that sense, I feel like maybe it's a bit more reasonable.
Good question. I'm not sure.
I think from the actual, like, pure face list, not that we see him that often because everyone's favoring hybrid, over any of the lists. In the pure faceless, I've seen Quickshot doubled up.
Right, I feel like it used to be that hybrid sometimes cut. Like, you would see it cut of like a lot of non-face decks, but I feel like Quickshot and Face Hunter is just an auto-include twice. What else would you put in instead? I can't really think of anything.
Just more minions.
More stuff to throw?
Yeah.
Well, we're gonna see that Face Hunter again.
This time against the Druid, and the Druid might have a problem if will not pick up the Dynasus Aspirant or Innovates.
Yep.
And look at that start from Visual. Oh,
oh
goodness, that hand. Double Mana Worm? Nope, double Juggler. And the Aspirant at least.
Oh, yeah, he got the Aspirant though.
And the Swipe, but he's missing the Innovates. Ooh.
But he has combo for turn 9.
Oh, awesome.
You're laughing now until it actually wins
yeah, until
the game.
He actually wins the game with combo.
Now there's a chance that Visual decides to play on tempo for the abusive, but the fact that you have double juggler really doesn't give you an excuse to not go for it. Is he going for the creeper? Yep, still plays around Aspirant with the abusive sergeant or the Glaivezuka depending.
Yeah, he has the answer. He doesn't have to do the like the juggler and hope, you know, he doesn't have to trade. Yeah, he does have the Glaivezuka there, so.
Now Visual with a good way to, you know, flesh out this curve. He's got the Leper Gnome picked up, which is the best way to complement his abusive.
Yep. And you do trade, right? You can't, do you want to ignore Aspirant?
And if you trade, sure you're giving up the prevention of a swipe, but ultimately, can you really afford not doing that? And then if he goes for that, Glaivezuka on the following turn is fine. You keep your juggler safe.
Yeah.
And then afterwards, you start playing those.
Yeah, because if you trade, you get the value from the 2/1/1s for one more turn at least.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not like you traded straight into a swipe.
Mm-hmm.
So that's pretty okay. Yeah, any extra damage you can squeeze in.
What did you say?
That's an innovate for low tap.
Yeah, you play low tap. You want the body on the board and then
same,
swipe next turn.
The problem is that if Visual is actually very defensive, he will trade.
He may trade. And the thing is, it might be tempting if the Glaivezuka lands, say, on a 2-attack minion, because then you use your weapon plus your 3-attack minion, you trade. That's mm-hmm. 5 damage you leave.
So are you guys suggesting we save the Innovate for the combo?
No, not at all.
No, you have to go.
I know, I'm joking.
That was 3rd degree. Too deep for me. 3 deep, 5 me. All right,
memes are real.
The Maymays.
Maymays?
Yeah, the Maymays.
Well, that's Glaivezuka. He just wants to drop it on the...
I mean, he has to be worried about swipe, right? Because if he doesn't worry about swipe, then Lothep sticks around forever.
Yeah.
And he takes a billion damage in the process.
And it lands on the Leper Gnome.
That's pretty sweet. The faster it dies, the less likely it gets keepered.
In Visual's position here, do you use face?
Probably.
Yeah, I would use face.
Yeah, you can get recurring damage, force a swipe, pick whatever you want. Because you can also kill a Druid of the Claw if it falls down sometime, you know, later on.
Actually, that's a good drop. Instead of the swipe.
Agreed.
Yeah, you can hold off now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely that. Instead of anything else.
Well, see, Force of Nature looked rubbish at first, but now we're looking at it from a removal perspective, and it's looking a lot less ugly. Because you can use it on turn 6 to kill the jugglers in this case. And
there's
anything
still a problem
left
with,
over, right?
Still a problem with Snake Trap.
That's true. If the Snake Trap shows up, then you're still in trouble.
The Owl's already in hand. So if that Druid of the Claw is being drawn, it makes no difference on the board. Would you kill?
The juggle misses after all is said and done. If you want to protect your juggler,
I think you do trade,
you gotta
right?
kill that.
You have another juggler, but you don't really have the guaranteed follow-up with the other juggler. And if you trade again, swipe's not quite as good.
Yeah. You're losing a lot of damage with the trade so far. We've seen 9 damage being thrown away, but if you don't, you're just losing even more, I think, over the long term.
The juggler should
in
gain
this,
you more
in those
damage.
Situations, yes, yeah. I agree. Now Palisade has to be played.
Yep.
I don't see another option. Like you have to get something on board. Just to have an option of trading up. Ooh.
Juggler, Snake Trap.
Because the thing right now is that RDU can check for Snake and then swipe.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
So he's got to like that. If he sees traps come out, he knows he's able to test for them. Doesn't even have to worry about explosive until he's ready to attack into them.
Yeah, but double knife jugglers?
Yeah, it's pretty
trap?
Scary.
Yeah, because even if you swipe, you're only killing one.
Yeah, one of the jugglers. Sure.
Well, he has two mana spare for...
To kill the other.
Kill the other one. But there's a lot of
Yeah, just because you're prop the snakes.
But you do take six in the process. Exactly. Or something takes six. All right, the owl here might be used unless he wants to trade the scientist and play the snake to get all the traps out.
I feel like you don't even trade the med scientist exactly. Just go face.
And RDU, however, will be able to check for the snake trap with the powdered shredder, and this combo is already in hand. Doesn't mean much for now.
He needs a national blow.
Yeah, he absolutely needs to find a way to...
Just to buy one more, an extra turn.
Exactly.
Without that, I don't see RDU winning this game.
I mean, there can only be four snakes on the board, though, right? There can only be three snakes that is on the board, which means he can't play more minions than that. And the swipe will kill the two jugglers. So what's the damage left for visual, like top decks from the rest of the game?
Well, that's...
And hero power.
Right. So Ancient of Lore buying one turn would maybe be enough that the combo with the 5-5 ends up winning.
I just think that the double jugglers right now are the biggest problem. Because if you go for the snake trap, it's six damage. This
what about Force of Nature damage. Then? Do you try it out? If you think it's snake? Because if it's not snake and it's explosive, then you're killing minions for free, which is great. If it is snake, then the trees may be able to kill the jugglers without you taking 100 damage in the process.
Ooh.
All right, he knows what it is, and he's not going to play into it.
So
hero power
he will just
down.
Not...
Never attack.
Never attack.
He's just going to go face with a double roar or something along the
line. I like that, actually.
Yeah.
Really like that.
Yeah, and Visual now. Well, he feels a little scared, but never mind.
It's 5 damage. He can kill the Pulse Shredder with his Med Scientist, get additional Explosive Trap, which is 2 damage. I actually like that. If you just silence, trade...
And smork.
And then smork, yes. You keep the kill command for turn 7. Seems good, man. Seems good.
Yeah. If your owl lives, which it will because the druid refuses to attack into your minions, you're gonna get an extra 5.
You will need another swipe. Or a wrath. And
a wrath
would target the
Druid of the
Knife Jugger anyway.
Pretty okay. But I think RDU may
good
have
juggle
to pull,
as well.
Good juggle. Good juggle. He's
gonna have to pull the trigger on that Force of Nature earlier than he wants, I think, but...
RDU needs an innovate. That's actually half decent. He can win next turn.
If he goes for Savage War Hero Power, go face, and then...
Yeah.
Pick up the innervate and win.
Then he doesn't need innervate.
He just Wild Growth, that's right. He just picked up the lethal.
Yeah. That's the way of winning the game.
Yeah, it's the winning
but
play.
The problem is, he will get 5... 7, 12.
He dies too many top decks.
No, he dies from the board and hand. Because there's skill command for 5. That's
6, 7,
12.
Eight,
that's 12.
Nine. Yeah, that's right. Exactly lethal.
So it's kind of unfortunate for RDU, but this Wild Growth and Innervate was an out for him to win next turn. And this way, Visual has the lethal.
It's the turn 7 kill command that he's been keeping. I mean, it was kind of obvious that the owl, if it didn't die, which it wasn't going to, since RDU committed to the full face play. RDU's nodding his head.
He knows.
Oh, this is the salt face.
I mean, it was very close.
Yeah, it was pretty close. That last extra mana that RDU got really made it closer than it otherwise would have been.
Yep, so now we're going to see Hunter versus RDU's Warlock, which is Zoo, right?
Right, and Zoo.
And the Zoo is not that great either.
I think RDU's entire lineup, and we spoke about that, is very weak to that one Hunter deck.
Agree. Yeah, this might be the Achilles foot in RDU's lineup. And the Unleashed Hound is already picked up.
But this opener from RDU, though, could stall. Look at that. He may be able to get the edge just because of this. As long as he dodges Explosive Traps, or finds the Defender of Argus to buff his minions.
Yeah, Defender of Argus would be the MVP on the Knife Jugglers, that's for sure.
Do you keep Unleash here?
I would keep it, yes. I would keep it because that's the comeback mechanism against Zoo with Knife Juggler.
Yeah, RDU throws one of the jugglers away, doesn't need two of those. He's looking for Defenders of Argus, is my assumption, eggs to protect against the traps. Just wants to make sure that he finds a little less of a, I want to keep my board alive. You know, if you play the jugglers, then you're trying to protect them. He's looking for the protectors.
Yeah, the creep is such a big draw for Visual, because otherwise, although he does want to do damage, hero power turn two never feels great, especially having no turn one play as well as the face hunter.
Double unleash.
Actually, a good draw for RDU. Explosive traps in hand, and sometimes it's even better than it's from Mad Scientist.
Yeah,
you have it in your hand because you can control the timing of it. Ooh.
That's a nice draw, though.
Do you like coin Gang Boss here?
But then you can't coin out the Defend of Argus.
Yeah, but doesn't the Gang Boss give you enough board presence to almost guarantee a good Argus later?
Void Terror.
But you do want to Defend of Argus 1 once. Because you need the.
Yeah, to push past the explosive.
Exactly. Alright. And he knows that he's not getting killed by, an example, a Glaivezooka here.
Yeah.
I mean, the Knife Jugger is not getting removed by Glaivezooka, then the problem might be a quick shot, kill command, an explosive.
Abusive Sergeant Glaivezooka into abuse, something else.
Okay, abusive Sergeant and a Glaivezooka.
Yeah.
There's a few things that Visual could have, but he doesn't have them right now.
Oh, this is looking pretty good for RDU actually so far.
Yeah, but the thing is that trap and this unleash basically turn the game upside down if they hit properly, if it's timed at the right spot.
Two drops or
solid?
Or M Gang Boss? That's the question.
Two drops is appealing, especially since it's a creeper, which means you can get the 1-1s out afterwards, whether you get them through the Void Terror.
If you're doing the 2-2 drops, do you actually trade the juggler into the 1-1?
First, yeah. Well, it could be first or after, it doesn't matter, but you do it afterwards. Because
if you do it first, then you have better chances to hit the minions instead of the face. That's actually a huge increase in chance because it's 66 to 75. Yeah.
But if you want to kill the 2-1 to protect your juggler,
then it's better to
try to do it.
Yeah.
So
he goes for the single juggle.
Okay.
And that's pretty consistent because if they want to kill. Oh!
Oh!
Wow! RDU!
What
justice has been served, at least partially, but now
he's
going to have to contend
helps.
With this.
The Glaivezooka helps here immensely. Without the Glaivezooka, he would push to use Explosive Trap, and then Explosive Trap gets diminished. Like, gets demolished by the Defend of Argus.
Exactly. So right now, Visual, he does pick up an answer to this juggler, but he had to slow down because that 2-1 snipe from RDU is bringing him back in this game like probably no other card could have at that stage. I mean,
what do you do? You can't play Defend of Argus yet.
Well, that's a tricky one. What if you attack? No. If you attack the scientist, it's pointless.
Yeah, I'm trying to work out whether you can make a like big enough Void Terror to I don't care about your explosive traps.
You
I'll race you with one big minion.
You just make one big Void Terror by killing the spiders, right?
I think you should trade first, though.
Well, it depends.
Oh, he's doing it that way. Right. Yeah. Okay. I didn't know if he was going to trade in with the Imp Gang Boss and use the 1-1
I think
it's going to spawn otherwise.
Oh, he's just smorking. He's forcing the hunter to make trades. If there's an unleash, you see explosive trap come out. Then you're protected anyway, because you're not attacking into that trap.
Yeah.
And you have the 1-1s to deny the snakes. You just have to dodge the unleash.
If you traded first, though, couldn't you have just gained the additional 1-1 from the...
Yeah, exactly.
The 1-1 imp doesn't do anything.
Yeah.
That's why I was worried that he just
it
didn't
snakes.
Attack.
That's it. It kills the creeper's little 1-1s and kills snakes. That's all it does.
Yeah, but would you not rather have the extra health? The extra plus 1 health to 6 instead of 5?
Against what? I'm not sure what. It helps. I guess it helps with a kind of kill command or quick shot play, perhaps. Yeah. Like unleash quick shot would, in fact, put you in a very bad spot because he attacks first and he unleashes.
Yep.
And then quick shots your 4-5. So maybe that one extra health would matter in that case for sure.
I just think if you plan to make the biggest minion you can to ignore explosive traps, then you make it as big as you can make it, right?
Yeah. So do you smork if you're visual here with that unleash?
I don't think so.
Because
if you smoke, then you're telling your opponent.
Make him trade.
I mean, you make a trap, right? Like, make him trade.
Yeah.
Means you have a snake, though. You have to make room for that snake trap. It's a giveaway.
Yeah, but if he trades and it doesn't spawn the snakes, is that so bad for him?
Yeah, kind of.
Really?
Yeah, it's a complete waste of the trap. Because. You might as well, because you're trading hounds.
But the gain he takes by trading, like attacking with all the hounds, plus
Also, you, like the two damage, how relevant?
Yeah, versus all the hounds attacking face, then your opponent has to trade.
Yeah.
Because you still filled the board, and if your opponent trades, then you've gained another turn of damage.
So you sacrifice two hounds to gain three snakes. I think it's worth it. But we'll see what RDU thinks. Right now, he picked up that, like, the fact that he has Defender is absolutely insane. But
I think this is the turn when you just have to play double Direwolves. Direwolf, and you go face with everything.
You check with the spider on the far left, maybe, for the explosive. Does he know what it is yet? No.
I mean, it kind of
got given away.
it kind of got given away, or it's just a really clever bluff. So checking first with the Spectre Spider is needed. Yeah. Now he knows it's Snake Trap, so he just ignores the minions because he has the defend of Argus. Right. So there are two options. Either you play the Dark Ardent Dwarf, which is better target for Defender of Argus next turn.
Yep.
Or you go for the double Direwolf, which have the same, plus one damage. They give plus one damage on the board. It's plus one. So there's no difference here. But having those two huge taunts.
Argus next turn is going to be massive.
Yeah.
Visual is probably not going to trade at any point here. He sees, I've got Arcane Golem, I've got the Unleash, I've got the Trap. I can probably just go full face and be fine with it, but he's going to have to be scared of Doomguards and POs.
He has to be scared of Argus.
Yeah, he's scared of everything at this stage. You know, the POs, the Doomguards, he's on 13 health. There's 10 damage on board.
So,
he needs to set the 4-5 and the 4-4 to 1.
To guarantee they die.
Which involves him taking face damage, right?
Well, what it involves is using your second Unleash.
Yeah, he can use basically. Yeah, he can use Unleash, actually. I think that's good, because you guarantee the explosive trap. Because if you don't do it, if you set them to two, you're screwed.
You get a few turns of free hero powers is what's happening.
Yeah.
By doing it this way. I think setting them to one, though, he has to spot it, not two. It's got to be one.
Oh.
And that looks like it's game just because of that. Maybe. Is it game?
No, it's not, because 10. The explosive trap deals with the 1-1s.
Close enough.
He's gonna that was game, right? No, it's not.
10. No, he's got. Well, he's one up. Wait.
One off.
He's one, because he can't play the Direwolf with it.
Yeah.
1 minute off, one damage off.
But he's on 17 health, so he should be okay.
I think he'll live.
Yeah, should be. You can just trade the 1-1s into the. He doesn't want to make the snakes.
Don't make snakes.
Yeah. You just attack. Argus attack.
Yeah, Argus attack. Then you have 12 damage this turn. But I'll probably just play the Direwolf Alpha instead.
Of the...
Just so you two off.
Yeah.
So two offs, which... Actually, is it better?
I mean, I feel like the difference is a minor one. I'm trying to figure out if there's ever a reason where you'd prefer...
Your opponent will trade the two hounds.
I think the abusive trades, the abusive trades less well with the board is the only big drawback.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Well, RDU on 15 here is going to be able to get himself 11 damage in, which means that Visual is going to feel a lot of pressure. Uh-oh.
Owl, okay. Does that help?
Well, actually, it might help clear the entire board is what it might help do.
Why?
No, it doesn't. Because you run the 1-1s into the 1 health minions anyway. But is it?
Yeah, it doesn't actually change anything. I don't think it is.
So 2-1-1s going at 4.
6, 10. It's 10 damage.
Yeah, it's not.
But that means that RDU, if he doesn't top deck a win, just doesn't have a minion on the board to finish the game. Because at 2 health, it looks like, you know, Visual is on the brink of death, but RDU still has to top deck. And then he's dead if he doesn't.
Well, he can get a Peddler into an Stuntas Boar.
That's right. True. He can get a Stuntas Boar. Is there any other one drop?
Well, Elven Archer would have been lethal if he would have used the Abusive Surgeon last turn.
Please let it not happen. Even Stuntas Boar would be lethal in that case.
Yeah, without. But he has like double
buffs.
Double buffs in his hand.
Yeah.
Any other charge minions for 1 mana?
I don't think so.
Yeah, like the boar is the only one, right?
Yeah, on 1 mana for warlocks, what can you find? There's really nothing. There's Voidwalker, but really nothing else. A coil would help him cycle if he picks up the peddler. Yeah, silence that spider.
So now he needs either just wait to finish up the game, and that's not it, or or a way to deal with that 4-2, like implosion.
Yeah, he's dead. If he doesn't tap into an answer, he's dead. So that's his last tap. His absolute last tap. And RDU is praying. And he picks up a way to handle the golem for sure. Guaranteed. Yeah,
it's going to hit for at least two, we hope.
Well, no matter what, you just play the egg, right? Worst case scenario, you buff that up. But now if Visual has a top deck, and everything in his deck deals damage.
Here we
go. Almost everything.
Oh my god!
What were you saying, Noxious?
Everything in the deck
deals damage except for that one card.
There's a
mad
scientist, there's a juggler, there's a creeper. That's all there is.
Six cards, and he already played one juggler.
One creeper, but no jugglers. Oh, I think he played one very early in the game, and RDU had to maneuver around it. There was a creeper turn, and then the juggler.
He played juggler, didn't he?
Oh, that was last game.
Oh, that was last game. Sorry.
But either way, one off lethal for Visual here, who's staring this down and he's thinking, can I make trades and live? But RDU doesn't care. He's like, yeah, I got buffs. If anything lives on this board, I win. I just dodged a bullet and I can come back.
Wow, what a game.
This has happened way too often. For a bad matchup, RDU pulled it off brilliantly.
Wow.
I mean, there are some few very close calls for both players, like the fact that Visual didn't trade to the minions with one HP.
That pretty much decided the game, actually, because there just wouldn't have been the same level of damage coming out.
Straight up
lost for RDU. No way of winning the race. No way.
And it only would have taken two damage. Like, it was two dogs. That's all they had to sacrifice.
That's the crazy. Only way to win would have had it, like, if he'd been holding at that stage two eggs, let's say. But that's, like, a very fringe case. And there's no way that he could have had those. Like, we saw his deck, right? Yeah. Or his hand. And he just didn't have the answers at that stage. So, RDU must be feeling relieved, but now it's Tempo Mage versus the Zoo. How do you reckon that's going to go?
That's actually a very close call.
Yeah, I was going to say, I'm just trying to think about how all the mechanics of the decks work out. That's actually a tough one. Because sometimes the Flame Waker doesn't do much versus Zoo, but then sometimes it does.
Right,
really
there's
weird.
There's times where it
depends
just
on board state, and you know, Squire, Egg, and Peddler, I mean, that's a pretty good start.
Double mana worm, though, how do you beat that? Okay, it's not the double.
I was like, what the hell?
I was going for it.
And actually, the Flame Cannon already in hand to deal with the 4-4 Nerubian, if you can proc it, is pretty big. If it's just the minion on the board. The second you start having to play like 50-50s with Flame Cannon, it can go very wrong.
Yeah, but look at that hand, man. He's on the coin, he's got the portal. Anything can happen, and it could get very nasty. But RDU is going to set up the egg so that if he gets abusive, or the PO from...
Oh my god.
Okay, no, this is nasty.
Okay, this is bad.
This is really an awesome hand.
But he has to play it properly. You have to play it well, because there are ways to mess this up. And I mean, if you're over-eager with when you pull the trigger on this entire sequence of cards.
Well, for example, we saw Vigil in the previous set when he played his Tempo Mage. He played Arcane Missiles when the following turn he had 4 mana to go Flamewaker Missiles.
Yeah.
And the missiles happened to hit the Peddler for 2 and the Zombie Child for 1, which cleared the board. But if that didn't clear the board, then he played Sorcerer's Apprentice, which would just die.
But he played it well.
It was really risky.
This time he played really well with the hero power instead.
I like that. See, what we were talking to you about that is I feel like he stepped up his game from yesterday. He does make plays sometimes that feel a bit shaky. But yesterday was really a very different story. He seemed to make a lot more misplays. Now, a little bit more on point.
Yes, and this is what I was talking about earlier. Suddenly, the Flame Waker combos don't look so nice.
Well, why not? You just coin, attack with the Man of Vim into the to the egg, then Flame Cannon. You have a 50-50 to kill the 4-4 and almost instantly take control of the whole game.
Yeah. I mean, you can even do that like later, but if defenders start coming out, if the egg is popped, and you're not able to, the health is just out of range, then suddenly it's not nearly as good.
I would also think about the Sorcerer's Apprentice into Frostbolt if I would be sure that my opponent doesn't have Abusive Surgeon.
Yeah, exactly.
And now he has to analyze, was it a case that there would be an Abusive Surgeon already played? And I think it was, right? Because it would have been used on the Mana Vern last turn instead of the Imp King Cross.
Just to get rid of the 1-2.
Just get the 4-4 already on board.
All right, he's going to go for the portal, and he's going to attack face. We won't probably get to see what the portal contains in Murloc.
You can play it.
That's good. It's more stuff on the board. And
it's a one mana free too, which is okay. Peddler? Definitely Peddler.
Yeah, I mean, honestly, the Sorcerer Apprentice has to die no matter what.
Ooh.
And the Coil lets you a little bit later down the line.
You could play Double Flame Imp.
That's very, very risky.
What about the Jouster? Can't you give it a shot?
Yeah.
Is the Coil just that much better? Because a 2-3 for one, it's kind of appealing if you win it.
If it loses,
yeah, it's devastating. Granted.
You can't really make a comeback too.
And the Coil with this Creeper, really.
I like this setup way more. It's way more flexible in the upcoming turns, especially with the Mortal Coil, so you can just finish up anything that will be hit on board. Like, even if there will be a Flame Waker with Coin and a Frostbolt or whatever, you still have options to kill that Flame Waker next turn, because you need to deal 3 damage into it when your board is pretty resilient.
Yeah.
Whatever will be happening with the pinks.
But now what Vigil has to do is pop the egg prior to anything if he wants to. Like, you know, you pop the egg first and then maybe you Frostbolt the 4-4.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
If you want to do anything here with the Flame Waker, it has to be in a very specific order. Going all in on the pinks here risks a lot of them being wasted away. Unless you double buff the worm.
Well, that's kind of bad.
Well, you...
You could double buff the worm.
I wonder whether you want to prop the egg with the 3-2. Would you Frostbolt something else over the...
Frostbolt the Mana Worm? Seems like a
very good option. It didn't look like the hover was right on that one. Yeah, I feel like maybe attacking the spider and then popping the egg with the Frostbolt and trading away the Mana Worm into it gives you a lot more chances of getting things done, because now you're just spawning an imp. And that might not do very much. And if he's smorking with this, that's maybe too aggressive, but it kind of works for him right now.
Let's see what are the options. Oh my god! That's a good draw.
Yeah, couldn't have been much better with that Coil to complement the kill.
So you can clear Mortal Coil the Mana Worm first, because that's what you have to get rid of too. And you have 4 more damage to kill the Flame Worker also, but you can first see what is the draw in case it will be a Defender of Argon.
Oh, well, that's...
But I think you still go for Hunter, Creeper, Abusive Sergeant, and Flame Waker.
Yeah, you have to kill the Flame
Waker. Just play all the minions. You've just seen a Flame Waker go all in on Frostbolt.
Yeah.
And if there's an Arcane Missile on the back end, or any spell for that matter, you don't want it to give more value than it already does.
Yeah, agree. And from and the next thing, you just make sure that you would taunt up Hunter, Creeper with the 4-4.
Yeah.
So you have great wall that has to be first breached by the minions from Temple Mage.
The Wall of Romania. Yeah, this is looking very good for RDU right now. Vigil could pick up some crazy swing cards, but the Drake, not appealing. You're just sacrificing your 4-4.
I kind of would like to see the Flame Imp from the other side of the 4-4 minion.
Yeah, just in case one gets cleared.
Just in case that your Defender of Argos will have to buff the Hunted Creeper and the 3-2. When the 4-4 will die.
Yep.
Because there's an option that the opponent will just ping the 4-4, and then you don't want to buff the 2-1 into a taunt, because it's just kind of useless.
Yeah. And you're also seeing one Frostbolt putting the Flame Imp to 3 health. It's like, well.
It's very awkward.
It's a much better health range than 2.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So if you're Vigil here, you've already played a Frostbolt. You have 2 Fireballs and a Frostbolt left in your deck. Do you go all in?
No, you just play the Drake.
And no, I mean, do you go all in? On hoping to find the damage in your deck, right?
Yeah.
I think.
Or do you start trading with the 1-1s? Like, it doesn't make much sense to me.
No, I think because you've got Dr. Boom as well, and even against this Zoo board, although it's very threatening, you're on pretty much full health, so you've got some time at least. I think if you can push to Dr. Boom and then hope
that's
that ends
even
again.
Better, right?
Yeah. I mean, this Lozeb is crushing. You might wait a bit if you feel like. You might wait like 1 or 2 turns, perhaps for turn 8, depending. Maybe your turn 7, that is.
I don't know, I would just...
Defender looks
just
really good.
Trade the Imp and the 1-1 away as well, and then just play Lothab. What does your opponent do to that board?
Yeah, Flame Strike's not even an option in a deck like that, and on 6 mana, there's nothing you can do. Like,
yeah, well... And then you can Argus the Lothab and the 4-4 next turn.
Yeah, that looks good. That looks
as well as tap,
pretty unmanageable, basically.
I like that.
Are you just going all in? I mean, it's fine. If he's being aggressive here, it's a perfectly fine play.
I mean, he can trade Flame Imp and 1-1.
Yeah, I did. Yeah, I mean, if he wants to Argus now instead of Lotheb, that's fine. I just think you do kill the Drake. It's such a... You're just throwing away a 3-2 and a 1-1, like, and keeping hold of everything else.
Oh,
I'm gonna go hyper aggressive.
Super aggressive.
Uh-oh.
Ooh.
If that flame cannon hits the 5-5, and the fireball goes face, and the fireball gets top decked, I mean, the Lotheb will stop it, at least.
Yeah.
But, I mean, there's a chance. There was a slight chance.
I like the aggressiveness of RDO here in this situation, because it helps him to win the game before there's a chance there might be some big impact minions on board, yeah. Like Dr. Boom, an example.
Yeah,
right. You play, just because of the turn where you play Lotheb, there's no way that spells come out, so your Lotheb is going to get a free ticket to going face. And on 17 health, that means a lot of top decks in your deck win the game, and the opponent probably can't kill you then.
Yeah, this is a really rough position for Vigil. What do you even do at this point? Because the second you start putting fireballs, when your opponent's on 14 health, and you start putting fireballs into like the 5-5, for example.
I don't mind fireballing the 5-5 and playing the scientist, right? And then maybe hoping to get something as a follow, because you're playing Boom afterwards.
Yeah, I mean, Boom's like the saving grace here, isn't it? Like, yeah. He just has to get to Boom and hope that's enough at this point.
It does make sense.
Yeah.
It works pretty well. And now RDU's damage output is fairly limited. Right.
Oh.
I lied.
Yo. How much damage is there?
14, I think, if I just quick count.
11, I don't know.
4, 6, 9, 13.
13 damage, yeah. Oh, it's one, like one, a little bit close. But above that. It's not lethal, but with Lotheb.
You play Lotheb, you kill the Azure Drake with the 2-1-1s, and you push face with everything else.
Yep. You're not scared of the 2-2.
Oh, you even just sacrifice the Defender of Argus instead. Because yeah. You have more minions.
Instead of just one little targetable thing,
yes.
Right?
Exactly.
You need all as many minions as possible to be able to power overwhelm.
As many power overwhelmable minions as possible. Now, RDU here is just technically thinking about the value of having more minions as opposed to having less of them.
Mm-hmm.
That's
because
the last
sure
decision he's
would,
got to make.
Yeah, he for sure would trade for the Dash Drake.
Yeah.
And probably will leave the Mad Scientist on board, because he knows that 7 mana is only a Frostbolt possible.
Yeah.
So he can kill the Loaded, but then still he has 5-7 exactly lethal with the board.
Yeah.
You know he's playing counters
now. Lethal without if he kills the Mad Scientist. That was actually
problem here
good
is, though, Vigil plays Counterspell, right?
Yeah, he does play Counterspell, which I was going to say, the PO doesn't work here.
Oh.
So, but there is 12 damage on the board for RDU nonetheless, so he still wins if his minions don't get pinged. And right now, Vigil knows I can't play Dr. Boom because I die. Unless RDU starts playing around things that aren't there.
Yeah, so we do have confirmation that it is Counterspell that is active at the moment. But like you said, I mean, you play Dr. Boom. If you don't play Boom, do you win ever? And if you don't play...
I mean, if you play Boom, you lose.
And
right.
If you ping, well, you ping play Clockwork. No,
so if you ping face, let's assume you were to ping face 13. You have Fireball for 6, so you've got him down to 7. Which is not nearly enough for you to win. Even double fireball doesn't.
But you can't ping face this turn. You need to ping the minion or you die.
Right, you have to kill the 2-1 no matter what.
Yeah.
So there's no way over 2 turns, even
yeah,
after
and this
right
is the
now.
Issue, isn't it? It's like he can stay alive for one more turn, but the
Ethereal
following turn.
Ethereal Conjurer
dead.
With Ice Block.
And then what does he do the turn after that?
I don't know, but that's what I've got for him to live. Maybe get a spare part that freezes as well. Oh, well, that kind of sucks. It's no Doomguard, but.
So you probably don't want to tap, right?
You might tap, but that's risky.
Oh.
You've seen a fireball. What could kill you? What's the worst?
I'm not sure. So you want
Finley
to...
Finley reset his hero power?
Finley allows him to reason
right?
Now. So yeah. He could technically heal himself
Hunter
or armor
power?
Up. Yeah, that's lethal.
Yeah, Hunter. Finley into Hunter. Oh, God.
Oh, do
please,
it.
Please.
Or worst case scenario, you heal yourself, but you might kill him.
Oh,
you heal yourself. No, you go with the heal. just heal yourself. You're good to go. Play the priest game.
Well, to be honest, I think I would go for the druid.
So, I mean, it's a good halfway point and you win next turn with
yeah.
It, and you're still healing somehow.
Yeah. In case, because there's a flame strike.
Oh, this is good. I'm loving
and
this.
And Arcane Missiles, right?
Yeah.
Then you just win the game anyway.
But now, what if there's a flame strike? Doesn't matter.
With one card draw.
Unstable
oh.
Portal.
Deathwing?
A Deathwing is not playable. I'm sorry, right here it's not playable.
Yeah.
Alec here for 5 plus the Whirling Blades. represents quite a good chunk of damage. Bloody Watch, you can ping your own face.
Yes.
You can ping your own face and be done with it. End the misery. RDU made it.
To the final. He didn't make it.
Right. But it is sort of a make it.
But he had unfavorable matchups. Definitely unfavorable matchups.
And the Sudoku is committed by Visual here. RDU from the brink of death. Actually, he was close to losing.
Yeah, very close.
Very close to it. 2 games.
Yeah. That was Yeah, I mean, that was intense for RDU, I imagine. He knew his lineup didn't perform well, and after the first couple of games it went a little bit downhill for him, he did manage to keep it together and finish up quite
Definitely
strong.
Played very calm.
Yeah,
very
calm.
No rush decisions. He was very strict about thinking about everything. Even, like, I really liked the fact that when there was the situation with the Azure Drakes, with the Azure Drake, there was a 4-2 minion, and the
right.
scientist, he thought about, if I trade, what are my outs? If he gets, like, is that an option I will lose after? I will sacrifice additional 2 damage. And I think that the trade with the Mad Scientist was kind of shaky.
But if you think about Unstable Portal, does it make sense? Is there a world in which suddenly things become difficult because the Scientist is on the board with Unstable? It's it's the kind of thing where, am I going to get, you know, a juggler plus a peddler with a soul fire to the face, and I play boom, which is fine most of the time, or
now, if someone reasons
play.
That like this after the game, I will call
that's what I'm thinking with RDU. I mean, I think leaving the, like, killing the scientist may have to do with what could come out of a portal that suddenly just gives him extra reach, which suddenly an additional spell on top of that kills me.
Yeah, I think RDU really displayed how controlled he can be. Like, he went aggressive when he had the opening to go aggressive, and then especially versus the Hunter matchups, he played like defensive and safe just up until the right moment, and then pushed himself to be able to finish off the game.
Exactly.
Well. So it was just really good control and knowing a full reach of both decks whenever, in whatever matchup he was playing.
And Visual as well. Let's mention him. He finished in the top 4. Super JJ and him are sharing 3rd and 4th place, respectively. So they're going home with 2.5k each, which is nothing to scoff at.
Definitely.
2nd place is going to be either Legendaren or RDU going home with 5k. So they're both in the top. And RDU wants to get the win. Legendaren wants to get a big win, really, under his name. You know, Bell, like, RDU has kind of a title already. He's got a few of them in the past. His reputation's established.
Yeah, RDU's very established, and Legendaren is, I would say, halfway there.
Yeah.
He just needs to just push out one more big performance this year, and then go into next year quite strong, is his plan.
Well, he won already the Jafinity, right?
Yeah, exactly. And I think especially a lot of the guys, especially on LC actually, looking forward to the fact that the ladder experiences change a little bit and the way the BlizzCon points are changing.
Yeah.
And it's much more open tournaments with no invites anymore. For a lot of the next circuit. And that's something like, and especially ladder performance, which is some of those guys excel at. Something really, like, looking into have a strong next year.
Yeah, I'm hoping we see more fresh names. That would be, or at least old names, but, you know, the ones that we don't hear too much about, just kind of make it to the forefront. That being said, guys, we will be taking a short break before we move on to the last match of the day. It's going to be the finals between Legendaren and RDU battling for first place in the Insomniac Truce of our champions, guys. Stay tuned. We'll be right back.